Yesterday, we took some steps towards adding signal and bias in a realistic situation where the signal comes from a source that is ground referenced and also the bias is as well ground referenced. Okay. And what we made use of was the fact that the signal has a certain frequency which is not zero. Okay. The signal is at some frequency other than zero. So, by using frequency dependent components like capacitors or inductors, we can add the signal and bias without losing either of them, okay, without losing any part of either the signal or the bias. So, we have our transistor which is biased like this. And between these two terminals, the bias network is equivalent to this voltage, the divided voltage in series with a resistance R1 parallel R2. Okay. And to that, we have to add our signal source. Yesterday, we carried out all our calculations using a signal source which had no internal resistance, but you can put it, and the calculations are just as simple. Let's say this is Vi and oops. Vi and RS, and again let me emphasize that this is just a representation. I mean, for instance, this node is not available anywhere. Okay. The series combination of Vi and RS stands for whatever comes before this. It could be a microphone, it could be another amplifier or whatever circuit comes before this one. And how do we do this? We couple it through a capacitor C1, and the idea is quite simple. If the reactance of the capacitor at the signal frequency is very small, and we have to say very small compared to what, but if it is very small, it behaves like a short circuit. So, it is like connecting the signal directly to that point. Okay. So, now what is the signal component that appears here in this circuit? What do we get? I asked you to calculate it, right? If the capacitor does indeed behave like a short circuit, what is it that we get? Yeah. What is the signal here? What is the signal that we get? What is the difficulty with this circuit? Plus RS. Okay. Now, first of all, there is some attenuation. The capacitor does behave like a short circuit. We have to see what the criterion for that is. Okay. But there is an attenuation. To make almost all of the signal come out, what should you do? To make almost all of Vi appear between gate and source, what should we do? Yeah. So, we have to choose R1 and R2 to be very large. Now, is there any other constraint that prevents us from doing that? Can we choose R1 and R2 to be arbitrarily large? So, let's say RS is 100 kilo ohms like we were using. If VDD is 23 volts, I mean R1 and R2 can be anything. So, it could be, let's say, 2 mega ohm and 0.3 mega ohm. That gives me 3 volts. Also, I could use 20 mega ohm and 3 mega ohm. That also gives me 3 volts open circuit voltage, but can I choose any of these values? or is there some constraint? No, that's correct, but is there any effect on the functionality of the circuit? For instance, for biasing, does it make a difference if I choose 2 and 0.3 or 20 and 3 or 230? I mean, yeah, so if the gate current, we will now assume that it is 0, okay, because it is a capacitor and the DC bias current is 0. So, in that case, clearly we can choose any value we want here. So, at least this part it is easy, okay. You just choose both R1 and R2 to be much more than RS, and of course, R1 by R2 should be the appropriate ratio so that you get the correct 3 volts at the gate. So, once you do that, you will have almost all of VI appearing between gate and source, okay. So, in this particular case, there is no restriction on choosing the there is no upper limit on R1 and R2, okay, because there is no gate current in the MOS transistor, okay. What is the constraint on C1 so that it appears like a short circuit? Please evaluate the transfer function between VI and VGS. So, I want to know what is VGS by VI. What is this function? Please calculate it quickly and tell me. Again, it is an impedance divider. If I consider this circuit here, C1 appears over there. So, the voltage gets divided between this R1 parallel R2 and the series combination of RS and C1, okay. So, VGS by VI would be R1 parallel R2 divided by RS plus R1 parallel R2 plus the impedance of the capacitor, which is 1 over j omega C1. And if I take this out, I get that, okay. Again, it is a high pass filter as you expect, right. If VI did have any DC, nothing would come through because the capacitor would block it. Now, what is the condition for C1 to appear like a short? What I mean by that is, this is the voltage that appears when C1 is a short, okay. This is the actual voltage that appears. At the signal frequency, I want these two to be nearly the same. So, that is the meaning of C1 as a short, okay. So, if you really shorted versus you keep C1, the value of C1 should be such that the voltage is nearly the same. So, what is the constraint? What is the constraint? C1 is very high, but how high? So, basically this quantity here, the magnitude of that must be much more than 1. So, then you neglect 1 and you can see that this turns out to be the same ratio as that one, okay. So, we want omega C1 times RS plus R1 parallel R2 to be much more than 1, or if you write it in terms of the reactance of the capacitor, 1 over omega C1 to be much less than RS plus R1 parallel R2, okay, where omega is the signal frequency. And if you do have a range of frequencies, this will be the lowest of the possible signal frequencies, okay. And yesterday we had got, what was that? 1 over omega C1 much less than R1 parallel R2, right. So, what is the general rule? I mean, can you just look at a circuit and tell me what the constraint on C1 is? The reactance of the capacitor must be much smaller than something. What is that quantity? What is the quantity? Where? What equivalent circuit? It is correct, it is some effective resistance, but where do I see that resistance? Where do I measure the resistance? Hmm? No, I mean, gate and source is incidental, right? That's specific to this circuit. So let's say I have some circuit with this capacitors and some resistors surrounding it, some circuit that is surrounding it, okay? And clearly it appears that the reactance of the, for the capacitor to appear to be a short, the reactance of the capacitor has to be much smaller than some resistance, okay? What is that resistance? Where do I measure it? Of what? I mean, the input is something, but between which two terminals do I measure the resistance? No, no, don't worry about this circuit. This is an amplifier. It could be anywhere, right? I mean, I could have such a circuit in the output or some other place in the circuit, okay? In? By VI. No. What is that? By the capacitor. So, I have to measure the resistance across the terminals of the capacitor, okay? So, I set VI to 0, okay? If I set VI to 0, this becomes a short circuit. Then, how do you evaluate the time constant in a first order circuit? Again, you have done this before, right? What do you do? Yeah, RC. Where is R? Where is C? I mean, C we know. First order circuit means there is only one capacitor. What is that R that appears next to it? Across it. So, you reduce the independent sources in the circuit to 0. The circuit can be arbitrarily complicated, okay, as long as it doesn't have any other capacitor or inductor. So, you have one capacitor and a whole bunch of things. It could have resistors, it could have linear dependent sources also, control sources. But you have a capacitor and across that you will have some effective resistance across the terminals of the capacitor. So, C times that R that appears across the capacitance, that is the time constant. So, similarly, I mean it is the same thing at play here. You have to measure the resistance that appears across the capacitor C1, okay? Without a? No, there are two different things. First of all, whether C1 appears like a short circuit compared to the resistance that is across it, that is independent of where you apply the input. Now, whether it is a high pass filter or not depends on where you apply the input. Okay, oh, you mean just by looking at the expression? Oh, that, yeah, I have j omega here, right? This is 0 at omega equal to 0, this expression. And as omega becomes very large, this term dominates and it becomes 1. So, I know that it goes from 0 to 1 and stays at 1. So, I know that it is a high pass filter, okay. So, in general, I think you know the first, you should know the first order transfer functions at least. A prototype low pass filter transfer function is, sorry, this is a high pass filter transfer function. So, this you can see. At DC, when S equals 0, this is 0, and when magnitude of S by omega p becomes much more than 1, that is at a frequency much more than omega p, this becomes 1. And the complementary one, which is the low pass filter, is 1 plus S by omega p. This is 1 for very low frequencies or S equal to 0, but for frequencies much beyond omega p, this starts falling off, okay. So, here we have to measure the resistance across the terminals of the capacitor, okay. So, if I draw the small signal equivalent of this, the incremental linear equivalent of this, I get RS VI C1 R1 parallel R2, and then I have my MOS transistor, which is really not relevant to this calculation, okay. So, now I short this one, okay. Then I look at what resistance appears across C1. What is that? What is the resistance that appears across C1? RS plus R1 parallel R2, okay. So, the resistance that appears across C1 is RS plus R1 parallel R2. So, the reactance of the capacitor should be much smaller than that, okay. Is this fine? What is the resistance that appears across the capacitor? Yeah, that is correct. Thanks. Okay, so you look across the capacitor. Now, in this case, you actually see some physical resistors, R1 and RS and R1 parallel R2. That may not be the case. You may see some part of some control source and so on. But in every case, if when we say it appears like a short circuit, this is the condition that applies. Okay. Any questions about this? Or in other words, C1 has to be much more than 1 over omega times RS plus R1 parallel R2. Okay. So, you calculate this, you know RS, you would have chosen R1 and R2 both to be much more than RS, so that there is no signal attenuation, and then you choose C1 based on those values. Okay. Any idea how much greater than it should be when we say write this? Much, much greater than 10 times, 100 times. Who is the greediest? Yeah, okay. Let's say that let's take a term of this type, the denominator, right? I said that the magnitude of this. Essentially, the denominator is of the form 1 plus jx, okay, and the magnitude of this should be approximately equal to the magnitude of jx itself, okay. So, what should be x so that these are within 1% of each other? That means this one magnitude of 1 plus jx equals 1.01 times magnitude of jx. So, how much would x be? Please calculate quickly. I mean, it appears close enough, right? 1.01 is appears to be a close enough number for this purpose. That is, we have a small change in signal of the order of 1% in amplitude. That appears okay. What is the magnitude square of this? What is the squared magnitude of this one? 1 plus x square. And I want this to be 1.01 times x square. Okay. So, clearly x equal to 10 will satisfy this, right? This will become 101 and this will become 101. Okay. What's that? 1.01 square. Oh, yeah, sorry. So, yeah, it should be 10 divided by root 2, right? Which is 5 times square root of 2, is that correct? So, it is about 7 times. So, the point is you do not have to go overwhelmingly larger than, I mean, when you say much greater than, just although we write that symbol, in this particular case, I mean, a capacitor that is 10 times larger than limit is perfectly adequate. Okay. And this is quite important in the lab next semester, because usually students interpret a large capacitor as largest or the fattest capacitor that you can find in the lab. That is not the idea. So, it depends on what is connected to the capacitor. Okay. So, the reactance has to be much smaller than the resistance that appears across it. Okay. So, I think now we have spent enough time on this and you understand this. This business of adding the signal through a capacitor to a DC value, this is known as AC coupling. Okay. That means that you have a capacitor which blocks DC, or sometimes it is called DC blocking also. In this particular case, we think of this as passing the AC signal. AC meaning this has a frequency that is not zero. So, this is an capacitive network, this is known as an AC coupling network. Okay. Now, our amplifier is sort of half complete. The signal picture that we wanted is this. And the picture we have so far is that the input side looks perfectly fine now. Okay. Here we do get 3 volts plus VI if we choose all the components correctly, R1 and R2 to be much larger than RS. And the reactance of C1 to be much smaller than RS plus R1 parallel R2. Okay. Now what do we do for the output? We want RL to appear between drain and source. What should we do? Again, a similar thing applies, right? Because the signal frequency is now known to be not zero. Okay, so you can use frequency dependent components to do what you want. So please suggest some alternatives. What can I do? Previously, what I did was, to bias the drain source, I had a resistor here. Okay, now let's say that I want to get something that is exactly like this. That is, I want RL to appear between drain and source. What should I do? How? That won't bias anything, right? Let's get into that later. You can't connect the current source there because you don't know what the VDS value will be. What should I do? First of all, if RL could be connected like this, that is perfectly fine. We are done, right? So it will do the job and that's all that's there to it. Okay? Because then it appears between drain and small signal ground and that's all. Okay? Now let's say that RL is also referred to ground like this, because RL after all is also the looking in resistance of some other device, maybe the input resistance of some other amplifier. Okay? So it's not some physical resistance that you can stick between two terminals. So if this is the situation, what should I do? First of all, it's clear that I have to have something here because there is some quiescent drain current and there has to be a path for that. Okay? What is it that provides a path in the quiescent or the DC operating point picture but doesn't have that in the signal picture? What should I do? Inductor. So if I do use an inductor, of course now my operating point has shifted, but let's not worry about that. If I do use an inductor, okay, I can adjust the size of the inductance so that what should happen at the signal frequency? Act like open, yeah. So just like a capacitor should appear as a short at the signal frequency, the inductor should appear as an open circuit at the signal frequency. Now I still have this problem of connecting my RL. How do I do that? I have my RL here, which is reference to ground. So what should I connect that to? No, I said that RL, one of the sides has to be grounded. It has to be connected to the common reference node. If I could connect both the terminals of RL somewhere, I would just connect it in series with the drain and to VDD, right? Connected to the drain, okay. Is this fine? What is the possible problem with this? What is the voltage across RL at the operating point? It's 20 volts, so it's VDD, okay. Now again, that may not be desirable. First of all, if it's just a resistor, then you can see that it is unnecessarily dissipating power, right? You have some whatever the supply voltages that appears across the load. And that may not even be permissible, okay, because if RL is part of some other component, this will disturb its operating point, okay. So what you would want is only the signal. What is the signal output here? What's the voltage there in the signal picture, in the incremental picture? What? Minus GMRL times VI. So let's say I want only this to appear across RL. So what should I do? Yeah, so that's what I'll have to do. Okay. If I do that, okay, now the inductor should be adjusted such that it's an open circuit at the signal frequency, and the capacitor should be adjusted such that it's a short circuit at the signal frequency. Okay. Is this fine? Any questions? Right now the quiescent VDS value equals VDD, okay, with the inductor, okay. So we have to choose the value of VDD, or we have to live with a larger quiescent voltage. It will be in saturation for sure, right? So this is where I have applied VDD. If I could connect RL like this, I am done, everything is done, okay, but I can't do that. RL has to have one of its terminals to be the common reference node of the circuit. And in the incremental picture, you see that it has to appear between drain and ground, okay. So to do that, what I do is, for signal frequencies, I make it appear between drain and source by coupling it through a capacitor, okay. So if the capacitor appears like a short circuit, then this RL will appear between drain and source as it should. Now this picture is fine for the signal, but it doesn't work for the operating point, because I have this operating point current of ID, which was 200 microamperes in this case. So where does it go? I have to provide some path to the supply, okay. And if you think of how I did the biasing earlier, so we had ID and that was going through RL to the supply voltage, okay. So if I leave it just like this, VDS will reduce to 0 and this will go out of saturation region, it will be in triode region. So I have to provide some path to the supply. So this ID has to flow through the supply through some component which should disappear for the signal frequencies, okay. So it should provide a path for DC, the 200 microampere constant current, but it should disappear, meaning it should become an open circuit for signal frequencies. So what is the alternative? That is an inductor, okay. Is this fine? At least intuitively this should look okay, because I can always choose L2 to be large enough so that it becomes an open circuit at the signal frequencies, and C2 to be large enough so that it becomes a short circuit at the signal frequency. Then it looks like in the signal picture only RL appears between drain and source, and that's it, okay. So now my complete amplifier looks like this. And this part we know how to choose the component values, the other side we have to figure out, okay. So what should, when we say L2 should be very large, how much should it be? So let's do it one by one. When you have multiple components, right, when you have multiple frequency dependent components, you get a high order transfer function, okay. I mean, in our case we are not interested in designing some specific transfer function. So what we do when we have these multiple components, and this happens in many circuits, right, you have many capacitors and inductors and so on, you assume that all other components are chosen appropriately. That is, when you are evaluating the constraint on L2, you assume that C1 and C2 are chosen such that they will be shorts, okay. So you do it one by one, right. So this is really a higher order system and you have to evaluate the higher order transfer function together. But again, what we want are just constraints. That is, L2 should be much larger than something so that the signal appears across the load, etc., etc., okay. So now let's look at the, let me draw the incremental picture. The incremental picture is this. Okay. Now I have to evaluate the constraint on L2. For that I'll assume that C1 and C2 already are chosen such that they behave like short circuits, okay. Now tell me what the constraint on L2 should be. Yeah, obviously you don't want any of the signal current to go into this, right? All of the signal current must flow into that, okay? So there is an impedance divider here, L2 and RL. So all of the signal current must flow into RL. So that means that omega L2 must be much greater than RL, okay? So in that case, all of the signal will flow into RL. Is that okay? C2 we will come to later, okay? There is some other point to be discussed. So all we are doing is exploiting the fact that the signal is at some frequency other than DC, and then using frequency dependent components like inductors and capacitors, okay? So when you want an open circuit for signals, right? Whereas a short circuit, when you want an open circuit for signals but short circuit for DC, you use an inductor of sufficiently large value. And when you want the other way, when you want a short circuit for the signal and open circuit for DC, you use a capacitor. That's all. So it's quite simple. So with this, it turns out that you can marry any kind of biasing circuit with any kind of signal picture, right? I mean, it may be very cumbersome. You may end up with very large number of inductors and capacitors, okay? So but you can, any branch that is shorted in the DC picture, you can open it by connecting an inductor in series of sufficiently large volume, okay? And anything that can be, that is open can be shorted by using a sufficiently large capacitor. Is this fine? And again, the same thing applies as before. This reactance, if it's about 10 times RL, it's okay. Of course, you can also use larger ones. Typically, I mean, these components also come in some standard values. So use the next standard value that's available. Any questions on the amplifier so far? What's that? Okay, let's not worry about what the VDS is. Now, if we choose to VDD to be 23 volts, VDS will also be 23 volts, and let it be that way for now, okay? Now, one of the problems with this circuit is that, again, inductors are bulky and frequently, in fact, it's not used in low frequency circuits at all now, because the value of the inductance required will be quite large and it will be bulky and expensive and so on, okay? So what you do is, instead you compromise and still use a resistor, okay? I'll call it RD, the drain biasing resistor. This will also work, meaning it will work for providing a path for ID to flow into VDD, okay? Is this fine? I mean, this is some practical constraint. If inductors could be made very efficient and very efficiently small and inexpensive, you would use inductors everywhere. But it turns out that, especially in low frequency circuits, this is difficult. In very high frequency circuits, it's okay, because it's the reactance that has to be much more than the load resistance. And if you go to gigahertz, I mean, even that large inductance could be only nanohenries or something. So that is okay, right? So in practice, in most of the circuits that we consider in medium frequencies, you don't want to use inductors, okay? So you still compromise and use a resistor, which does provide a path for DC. But the problem is that, what's the problem? It will have a drop across it, okay? When DC flows through it, there will be a drop across that. So what is the quiescent value here? What is the operating point VDS in this circuit? VDD minus ID times RD. If you used an inductor, it would be VDD itself. If you use a resistor, it should be VDD minus ID RD. So you have to choose VDD and RD such that you get your desired VDS, okay? Just like before. Before I was only interested in biasing and I did that. Now you have to choose RD in that way, okay? So what does this mean in the signal picture? Here, what happens? So this L2 is replaced with a resistor, okay? So what is the effect on the amplifier? Is there any effect? I mean, is it the same thing whether you use L2 or, an inductor or a resistor? Huh? Gain is now decreased. Okay, what is the gain? Assuming that capacitors are short circuits, what is the gain? GM times RD. RD parallel RL. So the gain is, never forget the minus sign, GM times RD parallel RL instead of minus GM RL. So it is reduced, but if you are constrained to use a resistor, you have to take the hit. Okay. Now you can kind of mitigate the situation by choosing a very large RD, right? If RD is much more than RL, these two gains will be approximately the same. But what's the disadvantage of doing that? You have to use a large, very, very large supply voltage. Okay. So it's a dual situation to what we had at the input. Here, to reduce signal attenuation between the input source VI and the gate source, we had to use R1 and R2 to be very large. Okay. But thankfully, the DC picture did not pose any other constraint here. Okay. Because gate current is 0. If the gate current was not 0, we couldn't make that either. Right. Because gate current is 0, we can make R1 and R2 more or less arbitrarily large. Here, we would like to make RD much, much more than RL. But then we pay a very steep price, which is that we have to use a very, very large supply voltage. Okay. So we can't use that. So typically RD and RL will be comparable, and you do take a substantial hit in the gain. Okay. So you can't avoid that. Is this fine? Is it okay? So now let's see how to choose C2, right? Assume that C1 is a short circuit. In fact, for simplicity, you compute the transfer function. So let's say the voltage between these two is VGS, okay? And this is V0. So compute the transfer function V0 by VGS, okay? And also this voltage is, it's the drain source voltage. I call it VDS. Also compute VDS by VGS. Okay, so please do that. I'm saying you compute it from VGS because you don't have to worry about this part of it. You imagine that there is some VGS between these two, and from there you compute the transfer function to the drain, which is this, and to the load, which is over there. Okay, so please do that. What are the transfer functions? V0 by VGS. What is that? Minus GM. Minus GM. GM by C2 times RD RL divided by RD plus RL. Okay. Does it make intuitive sense? When C2 is a short circuit, what should it be? When C2 is a short circuit, what should be V0 by VGS? But just by looking at the circuit, minus GM RL, why? Minus GM RD parallel RL, right? If C2 is a short circuit, it should be minus GM RD parallel RL. And here you see that if C2 is a short circuit, meaning this term is dominant, it is this J omega C2 goes away and you have RD RL divided by RD plus RL, which is RD parallel RL. Okay. Now from this, it appears that what is the condition? What is the condition for C2 to appear like a short circuit? What I mean by that is, if you do make this a short circuit, you get some V0. And this transfer function should be very close to what you get when it is really a short circuit. Okay. So what is the condition? This term should have a magnitude that is much more than 1. Okay. So omega C2 times RD plus RL must be much more than 1. Okay. Or 1 over omega C2, which is the reactance of the capacitor, must be much smaller than RD plus RL. Now, is this consistent with the thumb rule that we described earlier? Not thumb rule, actually how to calculate this constraint and so on. What did we say earlier? The reactance of the capacitor must be much smaller than resistance where? That appears between the terminals of the capacitor. Is that correct? What happens if you said Vi equal to 0? You said Vi equal to 0, what will be VGS? 0. So, what happens to this current source? Open circuit. Okay. So, across the capacitor you have Rd plus RL and this is consistent. Okay. So, that part is always correct. I also asked you to evaluate VDS, right? What will be this VDS by VGS? What is that? Minus GM. The denominator I believe remains the same, right? RD plus RL. Then what is in the numerator? RD. Is that correct? Okay. What is the relevance of this? We will see. I mean, why I asked for this particular transfer function. Okay. And then also, we did not do this earlier when I had the inductor here, right? So, let us say we do have an inductor here and the inductor is chosen such that it is an open circuit. What will you get the constraint on C2 to be? So, let us say instead of the resistor, I did have an inductor here, okay, and inductor is chosen so that it is an open circuit at that frequency, okay. So, let us say L2 is infinity. So, then what will you get the constraint on C2 to be? Why? I mean, use the same exact same method that we used so far. Okay, just think about it. We will continue from there tomorrow.